Thanks a lot, Rory. Apparently the microphone is on. Thanks to all of you for coming today. I'm going to describe my book and talk about the analysis of my book. I never correct the introducer, but I'm not quite as optimistic maybe as I sometimes come across compared to others, but I see certain challenges and I'll talk about those. But my main job here is to introduce for the year my program, which is the China in the World program, which I direct, of which I'm very proud. And this is the first event of the year. We'll have many other events, and you ought to know about those events, and you can go online and visit the site. I wanted to introduce our three new postdoctoral fellows. They are Christina Lai, who comes from Georgetown University. Please stand up and show yourself. Thanks. Chi-Hung Wei, who comes from us from the University of Florida. And Dalton Lin, who comes to us from University of Wisconsin-Madison. I also wanted to introduce the new assistant director of the program, with whom you should be in contact if you have questions about the program. And he is Dan Sushensky, who has great management experience. He has great China experience, and he was a student at George Washington University. And I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to point out that Dan is with us because my former terrific assistant director, Yen Bennett, has moved on to greener pastures away from me and into the new Contemporary China Center at Piers. And you ought to know about the new Contemporary China Center at Piers under the fine leadership of Professor Yu Xie, a sociologist. And she moved to be the assistant director of that program. And I think everybody who knows me and knows the program and knows the way I operate in the sessions knows what high regard I hold Yen in. The program has been very successful, and Yen deserves a lot of that credit. I don't even know if she's here. Is she here?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Could you give her a round of applause? Okay, so now I'll get to the topic of the day, which is my book. I see two major challenges. I'm called optimistic. It just reminds me of a saying I heard at the State Department, which is that optimism is to diplomats what courage is to soldiers. That you have to get out of bed in the morning and try to wrestle with difficult problems. I do see them as very difficult problems. And whereas I see the China security threat differently than a lot of my colleagues in academia and in the media, I still see a real challenge posed by China's military modernization. I'll describe that in a moment. So the first challenge that I see is in that security realm, and that is how to dissuade China from destabilizing East Asia, a region that's really important to the United States and the rest of the world. And China can do that by trying to settle its many disputes with its neighbors through the use of coercion or the use of force. And this is a common problem with rising powers in their immediate region. And I think this challenge is often missed by various analysts who focus on two things that I think are at least at present wrongheaded. And one is that the United States is trying to drive China is trying to drive the United States entirely out of East Asia. I don't see a lot of persistent evidence of that. It might happen in the future, but I don't see a lot of persistent evidence of it now. And the second is that China is going to become, in the near term or the medium term, a global superpower rival of the United States. And I don't see either the intention or the capability for China to do that. I don't think China is going to be a peer competitor of the United States for a very long time in terms of overall national power on the political, economic, and especially the diplomatic front. But that's where the good news ends, and that's where my optimism ends. China doesn't need to be a peer competitor of the United States to develop capabilities that can pose major challenges for the United States in a region that matters greatly to us, where we have important allies and important security partners. It just needs to be able to spoil our whole day, and I would argue that China is already powerful enough to spoil our whole day, and it's going to get more powerful on those scores along those lines in the near future. So that's the security piece. The second challenge, I think, is even tougher. Again, to get to that question of optimism, how optimistic am I really? And that is how to convince China to actively contribute to solving problems around the world, global governance issues. that help keep the international system safe when they're dealt with properly. And I think of non-proliferation, I think of the maintenance of financial stability in the international economy, I think of regional stability and the prevention of humanitarian disasters around the world, and I think of environmental protection. And the problem is that China is still a developing country, and it's a developing country with a pretty hefty post-colonial nationalist chip on its shoulder. But it's also by far the largest and most powerful developing country ever, both in terms of material power and in terms of institutional position. And the problem is that globalization has created a situation in which the world needs all of the great powers in the system, and China is certainly one of them, to pull in a positive direction to solve various problems. No single country can solve them alone. So if China obstructs those global efforts, multilateral efforts by the other great powers, they'll be almost impossible to solve. But even if China sits on the sidelines and free rides on the efforts of others, those problems will be extremely difficult to solve. That's true for non-proliferation. That's true for combating regional and civil conflict. That's true for maintaining financial stability in the international economy. And that's true for fighting climate change. And never before has a developing country been asked to contribute so much to global stability as China is currently being asked. And as China continues to grow and its international footprint continues to grow, it is going to be asked even more. And it has enormous problems at home, as I will describe. So let's look at the security piece first, that regional stability piece. And I will, there we go. That's my one other slide. I'm not a PowerPoint pilot here. China has many points of friction with its neighbors. It is a rising power, particularly if you consider East Asia. It's certainly a rising power in East Asia. It has expanding economic and military reach. And that means it's rubbing up against its neighbors in new ways. In addition, it has multiple sovereignty disputes with its neighbors at sea. And that is a point that I'll return to in a minute. So China's neighbors and the United States need to dissuade China from settling those many disputes through the use of coercion, threats of force, or actual use of force if East Asia is going to stay stable. And if East Asia doesn't stay stable, it's going to affect the entire world, because East Asia is now so important to the entire world. And I don't want to make it seem like I'm picking on China on some kind of cultural level here. I do think the nature of the Chinese regime and the problems that the Chinese regime has at home complicate these issues greatly. But I'm not picking on China as a culture, because I look at the history, and I published an article in 2000 with Richard Betts about the potential issues of the rise of China in the future. And in that article, we pointed out that if China handles its rise in its region as badly as the United States handled its rise in its region in the late 19th century, we're in for big trouble. Right? We had a giant avoidable war with Spain, followed by a giant counterinsurgency war in the Philippines, all of which was arguably unnecessary because of a combination of domestic politics, strategic immaturity, and bad diplomacy. Right? And that could easily happen with a rising China. Right? China doesn't have to be a dominant power to get there. China's traditional military was a land military on the mainland of China, designed to do two things. And it's important that you know that the two things are the countering the opponents and the enemies of the Chinese Communist Party abroad and at home. It is a party army. It is not a national army. It is designed to fight the enemies of the Chinese Communist Party. It was not capable of projecting power abroad, with the exception of a small number of nuclear-tipped liquid-fueled missiles, often with the warheads not mated with the missiles because of the nature of the missiles. It was a kind of crude deterrent. Other than that, it was a land army that couldn't project power off its shores. So that traditional military is changing. And China is now able to get offshore and to harm its neighbors with that newfound capability, its military capability. And it's able to raise the cost significantly to forward deployed US forces in the region. Not dominate, not drive the United States out, but raise the cost of power projection for the United States, which is a key to American strategy, to be able to project power around the world, especially to important regions. And the capabilities are not there to dominate, but to hurt And that's significant enough. I take that extremely seriously. And they are asymmetric capabilities against a superior foe that even in the internal writings in China that we're not supposed to see, talk about the United States as a greatly superior foe, right? But that doesn't make China give up. They want to design approaches, doctrines, and strategies to take on that superior foe and make that superior foe think twice about intervening in the first place, to intervene more slowly if it chooses to intervene, and to get out over time if it chooses to get involved for the long term because of the high cost. And those capabilities are accurate, conventionally tipped ballistic missiles, often mobile missiles, including most recently, according to public reports, an anti-ship ballistic missile which can hit a large moving target at sea because it has terminal guidance capability after re-entry into the atmosphere. That is a significant new capability that puts at risk one of America's great assets in this in far-flung places of the world, which is naval air power on carriers. Submarines, some of them nuclear and some of them arguably even more significant, diesel-electric submarines that are relatively quiet in relatively large numbers that can do various things, including laying sophisticated sea mines, shooting cruise missiles, from under the surface of the ocean, and also shooting relatively sophisticated torpedoes. Cruise missiles in general, sometimes off fast boats, pose a threat to sometimes superior naval forces. Advanced aircraft, fourth generation aircraft, air defenses that can reach offshore and create a kind of umbrella where it makes it difficult for superior air forces to operate with impunity. Anti-satellite weapons. That can reduce some of America's great superiority in what's called C4ISR, the ability to know the battle space in which you're operating and communicate with your various forces about that. Cyber attacks, which even if in the unclassified realm, the cyber attacks were used against the US military, according to experts like my colleague James Mulvenin, who spoke in this forum before, they can potentially slow the logistics part of American military operations, which can slow the deployment of forces. So those could be significant even on the military front. And the nuclear modernization, I'll return to this in a minute. China has modernized that relatively backward nuclear force and now has nuclear-tipped road mobile missiles that can be fired much more quickly than the old liquid-fueled ones. And it has submarines, it's developing submarines, which according to public reports should come online relatively soon, where there'll be a sea-based nuclear deterrent able to range parts of the United States and eventually maybe all of the United States. So none of these things provide China a lead over the United States. They're not gonna provide China a lead in some realpolitik balance of power measure anytime soon, but they are significant capabilities designed to deter or delay or make an American president think twice about how he or she is going to operate in a future crisis or conflict with China. This is not a new Cold War. China is not necessarily going to be an enemy of the United States, but it poses real challenges. And although I have no nostalgia whatsoever for the Cold War, I think the Cold War was extremely dangerous. I think the Cold War was very serious. It needed to be fought. I'm glad the United States and its allies won the Cold War. So I'm not waxing poetic about the Cold War. But I think after the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962, in many ways, the diplomatic, the security logic of the Cold War was more simple than what we face in East Asia today in the following sense. After the 1962 Cuba Missile Crisis, the lines of the Cold War between the two camps were relatively clear. With the exception of West Berlin, you kind of knew where the communist camp was and where the anti-communist camp was. And what that meant was for one of the two camps to cross the lines would have been very, very aggressive indeed, because they would have seen it, they would have known it was revisionist offensive behavior, and they would have known that the likelihood of a retaliation was greater. And we know from Tversky and Kahneman's Nobel Prize winning work, Daniel Kahneman, Princeton professor, that actors will take greater risks and pay greater costs. Most actors in most places and most cultures will take greater risks and pay greater costs to defend what they believe is legitimately theirs or defend the legitimate status quo than they will to expand and take over new stuff. So in the Cold War, after the Cuban Missile Crisis, the lines were pretty clear. It would have taken a real aggressive actor to cross the Fulda Gap and go into Western Europe for the Soviets, or for the United States to invade Eastern Europe and liberate the Eastern European countries from communism. That would have been taken real aggression. Everybody recognized that, so it was relatively stable on that score. The problem in East Asia are these maritime disputes are create an environment in which no one knows what the legitimate status quo is in the first place. And it'd be easy to have a situation in which all of the actors believe they're defending something that is truly legitimately theirs, sincerely in their hearts believe that, and believe that the other actors are revisionist. And what does that mean according to Versey and Kahneman's thesis? That means they'd be more willing to run risks and pay costs to defend those claims. And if you look at the claims, China has disputes. It claims all of this. It's hard. Oh, what just happened? OK. I only worked at MIT. I don't actually, I'm not actually technologically sophisticated. Here we go. So this nine-dash line goes something like this. And there are disputes with the Philippines, a US ally, whose claims kind of go out like that. And with Vietnam, whose claims go very expansively out here. With Malaysia, whose claims rather expansively up here, right? And you could even say with Taiwan. But Taiwan has the same claims as the mainland because they created those claims under the Republic of China. Okay, and there's also Brunei down here has claims. So you have these overlapping claims. You have Taiwan itself, which is a sovereignty dispute that China is involved in, not over the territory per se, but over the sovereign status of the government in Taiwan. Is it a sovereign state or not? But that's an important thing because the status quo is unclear to the actors. The legitimate status quo is contested and potentially unclear. And then you have the Senkaku Islands, administered by Japan, claimed by China as the Diaoyu Islands. And there you have another dispute in which the actors, I believe, sincerely believe the islands are theirs. So people often say to me, is China being revisionist, expansionist? And I say, I almost wish it were true. I almost wish it were true that Chinese security analysts didn't actually believe that the nine-dash line was a legitimate claim. Because if they didn't believe it, it would be easier to deter them from pursuing those claims. I wish the Vietnamese didn't believe the nine-dash line was unjust. And they really believe it's unjust. The Filipinos believe it's unjust. I get no comfort out of that because I think about that human psychology, which applies to the vast majority of humans in history, doesn't apply to Hitler, but thank God Hitler was unusual. Right? That all these actors could try to defend their claims, and some of these actors are US allies like the Philippines and Japan. And some of them are partners of the United States that we're intensifying our relations with, like Malaysia. So we have to worry about these things. There are big escalation risks as well. And one of the problems in this situation, which is more complicated than the Cold War, is that the nuclear deterrent of China, which I described in detail for a reason, overlaps dangerously with the conventional systems that China has created to raise the cost of forward deployed US forces. So remember I said some of the best ways for China to raise the cost for US forward deployed forces are solid fueled, mobile, conventionally tipped missiles and submarines. What is China's nuclear modernized dyad built on? Road mobile solid fueled missiles under the same military units as the conventional ones, the second artillery, and submarines. Why is this important? The United States has a tradition in the modern era of exercising its military superiority in the conventional realm against potential and actual adversaries by putting at risk the conventional forces that put at risk our forward deployed forces. And doing that early in a conflict, taking out the command and control systems, the ability, the physical systems that can reach our people, and doing that relatively early in a conflict. But in this case, not only would the president be considering attacks on the homeland of a nuclear power for the first time, but attacks on systems that overlap with the nuclear deterrent of that nuclear power. So if you took out the command and control of the 2nd Artillery, would the Chinese leadership know that this wasn't part of a first strike against the nuclear deterrent? And would they feel that they needed to mobilize that nuclear deterrent earlier in an escalatory fashion? We don't know the answer to that. I hope we don't find out. But it gets at the point that China doesn't need to be 100 feet tall to pose big security challenges for the United States. It's already quite tall, and this is something that is going to pose problems for us and our allies in the time to come. Now, China does have a no first use doctrine, saying we will not use nuclear weapons unless someone else uses them first. But as I've written elsewhere, and I wrote in the book, the internal writings of the Chinese military, which we're not supposed to have access to, but we do, suggest that no first use is more of a guideline than a rule, and that there are extraordinary circumstances, like the United States launching massive conventional attacks against your command and control structure, one might think, in which that might be waived. So you have to take that seriously as well. I'm not so accepting of Chinese communist public doctrine on these things as some, and I take that extremely seriously. Another problem is all the regional powers, including all our friends and allies, are quite dependent on the Chinese economy. So if you're in a crisis, your doctrine better not be one that alienates all of your allies in the first place. And I'm not going to talk about why the United States has a big lead in overall power from China, but one of the big reasons is our alliance system. The United States has about 60 alliances and security partners around the world. What does China have? North Korea. Right? That's a real asset. Right? You don't, if that's the real source of your power and your regional presence, you don't want to alienate them early in a crisis. So to do the kind of robust early strikes that the United States has become accustomed to might alienate the allies that you're actually trying to protect, because they are very economically dependent on the mainland and they don't want escalation. So that's another challenge, another complexity, another complex situation for a future president to handle. And then there's domestic politics. And I try to emphasize this in the book. A lot of people talk about the difference between President Xi Jinping and his predecessor, President Hu Jintao, and they're very different in style. President Hu Jintao being very conservative in his public presence, in his mannerisms, in his career path. He came very slowly up the bureaucracy and got to the top. Xi Jinping being much more gregarious, much more outgoing, much more assertive in his personality. So people emphasize that. But I think there's something more significant that's happened recently that we should focus on that affects both Hu Jintao's government and Xi Jinping's government, and that's the financial crisis. The financial crisis of 2008 created real problems in our China policy. I was in the Bush administration. I think we had a good Asia policy. I think we had a good China policy. And then people say, there's so much more tension in the region now under Obama, and there's so much more tension with China, and there's so much more tension in the region, and the Obama administration must be screwing up across the board, and they might not be doing anything right. And I think this is an unfair comparison in a sense. Right? I'm not saying that everything's going great, but it's an unfair comparison because the China that the Obama administration is dealing with is not exactly the same China that the Bush administration was dealing with. The financial crisis did two things to China at the same time that made China more difficult to deal with. It made it much more confident on the international stage because the Chinese elites thought that the country had risen in overall power vis-a-vis other countries in a hurry. And it made the Chinese regime, the Chinese Communist Party, which is always essentially important in any analysis of Chinese security, less secure at home. Confident abroad and scared at home is the worst cell in the 2x2 table, right? From a security perspective for foreigners. It makes them the most difficult to deal with in tense situations. Why? Because they're confident they're gonna pursue their many claims that they say go back to the 1930s, to the previous regime, the KMT regime, nothing new. This has been our map forever, it's not revisionist. We're gonna pursue them when we get a chance. We now have some more power to do it. And then when others pursue their claims, more likely to be acerbic in reactions because nationalism is a major source of legitimacy for the party in addition to the economics. And leaders are reluctant to look weak on nationalist issues, particularly at a time when there are a lot of domestic protests and at a time when their peers can hold it against them as well. So you're in a tough position since 2008, regardless of whether it's Hu Jintao or Xi Jinping. The good news, there is some good news, and that is the economic interdependence that I described in the initial comments in the talk, the world is more integrated than ever before. We need more cooperation on global governance for a reason. We've never seen the kind of economic interdependence that we have today. Those who dismiss it because World War I happened in an economically interdependent Europe don't understand the difference between economic interdependence today and economic interdependence in the early 20th century Europe. Very different indeed. Transnational production, products produced in multiple countries, on-time delivery, and China's at the heart of that. Right? That means China's economy is influential on everybody, including some bad regimes that get targeted with sanctions, but it also means that China has real disincentives to attack all of its neighbors who are providing the parts of products that are really assembled in China more than they are made in China. Right? So that's a force for peace. I didn't want to give you all bad news. Now let's get on to bad news again. Global governance. I really do believe, you get all sorts of reviews of books and stuff. I really believe that some of the, a couple of the negative reviewers really missed this point in my book, which is that I think the global governance challenge for the US government is greater than the security challenge that I just laid out. And obviously, I don't think that that security challenge is small. It's greater in part because the US government has no experience trying to convince a large developing country with massive domestic problems to contribute persistently and constructively to the handling of problems around the world. And the problem is that the Chinese economy, while a developing country economy, with a, at the most generous measure in 2012, which is the last figure I had for my book, $9,000 per capita, about the same as Ecuador. So it's a developing country, but it's huge, and it's soon going to be the biggest economy in the world. What does that mean? You can't pressure certain regimes through economic sanctions and other types of non-kinetic, non-military pressure unless China is on board. China is by far the biggest economic partner of North Korea. China is the biggest economic partner of Iran, for example. Both imports and exports, both directions, right? And those governments will be just fine if the rest of the world sanctions them and China doesn't. So you have to convince this country with these problems at home and these problems in their economy to align with other countries, often richer countries, and some of the countries that are asking China to do this are the former oppressors of China in the nationalist narrative of the century of humiliation. So you're being asked by the wrong people, by the Americans, by the Japanese, by the British, by the French, to contribute to global stabilization. That doesn't make it any easier. So if a country the size of China does not contribute actively to non-proliferation efforts, you can forget it. There's a reason that the Obama administration talked about China frequently when they was doing the Iran deal. There's a reason that the Bush administration and the Obama administration talk about China first, second, and third when we talk about North Korean nuclear weapons. China is also by far the greatest greenhouse gas emitter, more than twice what the US emits, and that's nothing the US should be proud of because the US is way up there. Right? If China doesn't actively curb its greenhouse gases, the entire remittance process, or the process of trying to limit greenhouse gas emissions, is going to be defunct. Not simply because China is so important in and of itself, which is true, but because all of the other actors will say, why should we bother? When you see resistance in the United States to reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, it almost always has China in it. China's not doing enough, or India's not doing enough. The developing world's not doing enough. Why should we lose American jobs? But China is still a developing country. And again, the same per capita income as Ecuador. Nobody's asking the Ecuadorians to solve global problems and to contribute more to global governance. But it's not true for China because there's 1.3 billion Ecuadorians in China. Right? It's a giant economy. So you have to ask China to contribute, even if they have good, and this is what makes the diplomacy so difficult, even when they have good answers. We can't do that. You had relations with crappy regimes and got oil from them all through history. It's our turn, right? And it's not untrue, right? You say we're the biggest greenhouse gas emitters, but we have 1.3 billion people. Let's do a per capita measure. If we emitted greenhouse gases like you did, we'd all be drowning, they can say to Americans. And if you go in history and you look at the historical per capita emissions of China, it's even more stilted. It's actually the British are the worst. Americans are only second. So one of the problems is they have good arguments, and that makes it harder to convince them. But if they don't do it, you don't get anywhere, right? So you can't accept it and say, you know, you got a good point there, and then move on and just ignore the outcome. And then financial stability, one of my favorite stories. The Greek crisis, 2012, right? You have a crisis in Greece. I don't think the American diplomats are as guilty of this as the European diplomats and the Australian diplomats. Asking China to bail out Greece, and the logic was very clear. You know, China had a lot of cash. It's cash rich. It's got big current account surpluses for a long time. It's got big foreign exchange reserves. It could help Greece. Greece isn't that big of an economy. Right? So Europeans asked, the Australians asked China to step up and do this. But think about it, $9,000 a year per capita income. No social safety net. This is the ugly secret about China, right? The Chinese Communist Party, people say social security, welfare, they're all socialist programs. China doesn't have any of this stuff. It does have a big Leninist party, single party state, but it doesn't have a social safety net, particularly in the reform era where a lot of the state-owned enterprises were restructured and a lot of things went private. So you have a country that doesn't have a social safety net, that has $9,000 per capita GNP, and they're being asked to bail out whom? Greece. Greece's per capita GNP, and I say 9,000, that's the most expansive you can get. That's purchase power parity. It's controversial to ascribe that much wealth to China. Greece, you don't have to do that for, $24,000 a year in 2012. And they're broke. Well, why are they broke? Profligate government spending on an enormous social safety net. People have 14-month pensions. Everybody works for the government, right? And you're asking Chinese farmers, they're not peasants, by the way, they're farmers. There's no reason why Chinese people who grow stuff are peasants and Americans who grow stuff are farmers. Chinese farmers who are poor, right? Chinese farmers who are poor are being asked to subsidize these fat Europeans? Cut me a break. And that's what the blogosphere in China said. And that's what the poll suggested. It would be hard for a Chinese leader to face his own public, right? And say, I'm gonna give a bunch of money to Greece because they overspent on social security. Right. Not easy. Greenhouse gases, I already covered that. So there are ways to respond to these twin challenges. They're both very complicated. I personally think the global governance ones are even harder, in part because I worked in the US government, and the US government interagency process is structured for those kinds of coercive diplomatic crises. The diplomacy and the military, despite all the whining about the lack of functioning of the interagency process, is we do have a pretty good interagency process, and we're used to this. We're used to thinking in these terms of mixing threats and assurances and trying to de-escalate problems and using the military as a diplomatic tool and using diplomacy as a military tool and all sorts of things like that, right? But we'd have no experience in convincing a uniquely large developing country to contribute actively to solving global governance problems. So this is gonna be a big challenge for us. So what do we do? The subtitle of the book, I can go back now, is I can't go back. I may go back, but I cannot. Okay, there. The subtitle of the book is Shaping the Choices of a Rising Power. Why do I say that? The United States, its allies, its security partners are not gonna determine the policies of China. All they can do is create an environment in which Chinese come to the conclusion on their own that it makes more sense to try to reach national greatness, a goal of all Chinese across the political spectrum, through economic cooperation, diplomacy, constructive acts on the international stage, and dissuade China from seeking that greatness through coercion, the use of force that will destabilize its own region, arguably not only against our interests and our allies' interests, but against China's own interests. For the reasons I cited, the economic reasons alone, they don't have national interests in going that route either. You have to do this by having a very strong US military presence, a very strong alliance structure in the region. That's critically important. But you also have to couple that with diplomacy that doesn't suggest that we're trying to end China's economic growth, restrict China's ability under all circumstances to do more things on the international stage and get prestige in the process, or to actively overthrow the Chinese government or actively break up the country. Because if you're using that power, that forward deployed US power, and you're suggesting that, you're creating a situation in which that power doesn't serve a constructive purpose, it serves a destabilizing one. But if you can couple good diplomacy with a strong presence, you do two things. You reward China when it does constructive things, and I've been critical of some of the initial responses, the Asia Infrastructure Bank, which I actually think is a good thing for the region, it's a good thing for China to do with its money, and we should be celebrating it. Now we finally are, it was a little slow in coming. But that's a good thing, so you pat China on the back publicly, you say, you want national greatness, you want to end this century of humiliation, do stuff like this, build infrastructure in your region. One Belt, One Road, go into Central Asia, build infrastructure in Central Asia. Is that really a dire threat to our national security? Is it really the case that he who controls Tajikistan controls the globe? Right? I don't think so. I think it's actually good for China to have an interest in a stable Central Asia. Because Central Asia is going to pose a security threat for us, not from raw power, but from terrorist groups or instability. So if China having an interest in a stable Central Asia is probably good for us as well. So when it does the right thing, you have good diplomacy, you can reward China for that. But if it goes the coercive route, you have to be able to stand up to it. And we've seen it before. In the early 1990s, China was bullying its neighbors. The Clinton administration did the Nye Initiative, strengthened our alliances, and then China launched a very constructive set of diplomatic initiatives for about 10 years until the financial crisis as a response. So toughness doesn't always breed a negative reaction in China. That's just propaganda. It depends on the context. China's doing something constructive and you're tough, you're gonna undercut that constructive position. If China's doing something tough and you're tough, more likely that the moderate views in China are gonna win the day. They're gonna come to the fore and say, we have a better way to improve our diplomacy in Southeast Asia rather than building airstrips on previously unclaimed reefs that we just poured a bunch of sand on, right? So I think we have successes. The book ends with several chapters going back to George H.W. Bush, the last four or five chapters of the book, and goes up to the Obama administration and talks about, with these lenses of the security problem and the global governance problem, the achievements and failures of the administrations. And I'm a lifelong independent, so I try to be fair. I hope I am fair. I do think the Bush administration, when I served in the government, did a lot of things right. They did some things wrong, and I point that out as well. In my opinion, they did some things wrong. And with the Obama administration, I think they did some things wrong, but I don't necessarily dismiss everything they've done. And I try to look through the pluses and minuses. And for the Bush administration on the security front, there was a very tense period in cross-strait relations when I was in the government, because there was a government in Taiwan that was pursuing initiatives that appeared to be in the direction of a formal legal declaration of Taiwan independence. That's how it was seen on the mainland. That's how it was seen in places in the United States. And on the one hand, the United States sold an unprecedented amount of weaponry to Taiwan, coordinated tightly with the Taiwan military, telling the mainland, don't assume that if you coerce Taiwan physically, that there won't be a US response. Don't assume that we're not going to strengthen the Taiwan military in such instances. At the same time, the United States first privately and then publicly opposed those initiatives of the government in Taipei in the direction of independence. So you're mixing credible threats and credible assurances in a way that creates stability. You got a lot more stability. The situation across the straits has calmed down quite a bit. It might get more interesting next year, we'll see. And there might be more challenges for the Obama administration and its successor. But I think that was a success. For the Obama administration, the problems over the Senkaku Islands, the Diaoyu Islands, I think was handled relatively well. You had a situation in which China was up in arms because of various changes in Tokyo in policy towards the Senkaku Islands, not new sovereignty claims, but new legal changes where the central government was acquiring the islands under its own ownership as opposed to private ownership. No change in international law in any way, but China was up in arms about it, was using military and civilian police equipment to assert itself in the disputed areas in ways that was destabilizing. And I think the Obama administration did two things well. You have to do both. One is it reiterated at a very high level, eventually at the presidential level in 2014, that the Senkaku Islands are different. Unlike all the other maritime claims around the world in which the United States takes no position at all, the Senkaku Islands, while the United States takes no position on sovereignty, it takes a position on administrative control, because that was transferred from the United States, and it says Japan has administrative control, and therefore the U.S.-Japan alliance applies to the Senkakus. That's about as strong a statement as you can make. It was made by the president in Tokyo, right? And that was useful. I would have preferred it happened a little earlier, but you know, you can't have everything. In addition, from all public reports, the Obama administration discouraged the Japanese government from taking what were seen in America as unnecessarily provocative diplomatic and other positions on the islands to increase tensions. And what do you have now? It's still a tense environment, but it's much less tense than it was in 2012 and 2013, and that's a good outcome. So things can go right. The second thing you have to do is you have to invite China to solve problems like North Korea and Iran and to participate actively and give China credit when it does. When we were actually making some progress very briefly in the six-party talks in which I participated, I remember my boss, Chris Hill, every day when we got to the hotel at midnight negotiating with the North Koreans, he always started with, China was great today. They really helped a lot. Right? And that's what that's the attitude you have today, because they're doing the right thing. If they're pulling in the right direction, you have to do the right thing. But if they're not pulling in the right direction, then you have to do the opposite. And there's a good example. 2010 was a bad year in Chinese diplomacy, a really bad year in Chinese diplomacy. Not just by my measures, but by Chinese experts' measures. Really bad year. One of the reasons it was a bad year is North Korea was acting even more obnoxious than normal. Even by North Korean standards, North Korea was belligerent in 2010. Sunk a South Korean corvette with the death of dozens of sailors, and then shelled a South Korean-held island, killing two service people and two civilians. And China's position during that was what? When the United States and others asked China to help to restrain North Korea? Nobody do anything escalatory. You know, think about a parent with kids. One kid just slugs the other kid across the jaw, and the parent's response is, no escalation. Right? No, there's no bad guy here, it's just tense. It's like a bad weather, be careful. Right? So South Korea was upset, Japan was upset, the United States was upset, and they're pushing, they're trying to get China to do the right thing, it doesn't. So what does the United States do? Tightens relations with South Korea, particularly on missile defense. Tightens relations with South Korea on anti-submarine warfare, because it was a submarine that sank the ship. Tightens relations with Japan on both of those things, and miraculously, for a while, gets South Korea and Japan to talk about stuff together. And I was in China at the time. China doesn't like it when South Korea and Japan are talking to each other. You know, it's like the canary in the coal mine, right? Something must be terribly wrong if South Korea and Japan are getting along. And they did, by all public reports, restrain North Korea later in the year, in December, when North Korea made another round of threats and then didn't carry through with those threats. And all the public reports suggest China pulled on the chain. So that can work, right? Focus on proscribed, this might be a little controversial now with the Syria crisis. Focus on proscribed behavior of target regimes around the world, not regime change. If you want China on board and you need China on board, you can't start by talking about regime change because the Chinese will not be on board. So in the Syria crisis, when you open with Assad has to go, you've lost China. This is a bipartisan fetish in American diplomacy. And even if we want a regime to go, if China doesn't want them to go and is willing to have normal relations with them, they're not going anywhere. It's less true for Russia, certainly true for China, but it's true for both of them, that if you start with regime change, you're going to lose them. They're in the UN Security Council, they have vetoes, and they have wherewithal to help. So even if you want regime change, shut up about it. Focus on the prescribed behavior, and there's plenty of it in the regime in question, and get buy-in from local institutions, Africa Union, the Arab League, to join with you, the big former imperial powers, in putting pressure on the regime. Why? Because it undercuts the argument in China that this is all about great powers bullying little powers. And this worked in various places. It worked in Libya for a while. And it's a tale of two Libyas that's very telling. 2011, early 2011, I'm reading the New York Times. I dropped my coffee. Why did I drop my coffee? Says in the newspaper, unanimous UN Security Council resolution to refer Gaddafi's regime to the International Criminal Court. I know what that means, right? You don't have to be a former diplomat, right? That means that all the Security Council members voted yes. They had no abstention. China voted yes to refer an authoritarian regime to the International Criminal Court. Really? How did that happen? Well, the Obama administration approached the African Union, the Arab League first, then approached China. And Gaddafi was special. Russians hated him too. So China would have been totally alone in blocking any kind of sanction on Gaddafi, and they decided to go along with it. Then fast forward 2 months, what happens next? Use of force resolution. China doesn't surprise me. I don't drop my coffee. They abstain, which is what they bravely do when they don't want to take a controversial stance. They abstain. But what does that resolution do? It's designed to protect the people of Benghazi against attack. How is the resolution used? To become the air force for the vengeful opposition of Gaddafi until he was murdered, killed, executed, whatever you want to say, on the street. I'm no fan of Gaddafi. I don't miss him. But by doing that, it made cooperation on Syria impossible, absolutely impossible. And then when you open your Syria gambit with, before you say you want to negotiate, you say, he has to go, now let's negotiate. Well, if he has to go, you got to make him go. Or you have to negotiate. You can't say he has to go, now let's negotiate. Where's he going to go? Las Vegas? It's simple. This is like 101, right? So I'm critical of various administrations and how they handle things. And you know, I hate it when like the people that we're trying to convince to go in another direction are right. So when you're talking to Chinese diplomats, they say, exactly what incentive does Assad have to negotiate with you now? When you said he has to go? I don't have an answer to that. That's frustrating. The last thing, and I will shut up, the last thing is you try to find domestically for why China should cooperate with your demands and link those domestic forces in China to the international effort. This happened twice in my recollection. The WTO accession of China under stricter restrictions than developing countries had ever accepted before, in large part because the premier, Zhu Rongji, wanted to use that agreement to bash state-owned enterprises over the head for reform for reasons that he already had. It was a good linkage by the Clinton administration, and it worked out. Most recently, climate change. The Obama administration has made progress with China on climate change, not nearly as much as I would like, but it has made progress, and it's done it largely by linking the Chinese leadership's own domestic reasons to reduce low-altitude urban pollution and use these international agreements to get that done. So that's smart diplomacy. And we've seen smart diplomacy in places like Sudan, Darfur, where China turned not 180 degrees, but about 140 degrees in the time I was in the government from protecting the regime there against the pressure on the genocide to actually pressuring the regime to accept the UN program and then dispatching the first non-African peacekeeping forces to Darfur. So there are successes. And then there are real failures that I remember, like Burma, where the Bush administration signaled, like the Obama administration, that the real solution, sometimes in private conversations, was for the Burmese regime to go. And the Chinese kind of say, where are they going to go? Who's going to replace them? It's a multi-ethnic, highly armed society on our border. You really want to create that? I don't think so. So they veto. Same with Zimbabwe. They veto, because it looks like the US is about regime change, not about focusing on prescribed behavior. OK, so I have spoken for too long. I'd be happy to take questions. We have a rule here, which is that students get to ask questions first, even if it's all the questions, because we are a university. Okay. And if you could identify yourself, that would be great. Like what program you're in, anything else you want to say about yourself.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. I'm Dan Taub, a senior in the East Asian Studies Department. I look forward to reading your book. You mentioned the New Silk Road Initiative as something that we don't necessarily have to oppose. But how do you reconcile our support, or at least our verbal support, to sort of human rights in Xinjiang with the Silk Road Initiative in Tajikistan?
Well, it's a great question. I don't see any real natural contradiction between taking a position for civil liberties, religious freedom in Xinjiang, and for inviting China to invest in infrastructure projects in Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, and places like that. They're not necessarily at odds with each other. I'm not sure where the contradiction lies. It is important to know what the U.S. policy is and isn't on a place like Xinjiang. The United States recognizes Xinjiang as part of China. It's different than our policy towards Taiwan. It's the same as our policy toward Tibet. And what we emphasize there in our diplomacy with China is that even though we recognize it as part of your country and we're not supporting independence for that region, that doesn't mean you won't be held to standards, international standards of human rights on religious freedom, freedom of expression, et cetera. And this situation in Xinjiang is bad. At the same time, here's where you can make a link. At the same time, while China exaggerates by calling all opponents of Beijing's policies in Xinjiang, linking them with terrorists, which is, I think, is unfair and inaccurate, they do have a terrorism problem. So both of those things can be true. And to the degree that they have a stake in preventing international terrorism in Central Asia from reaching into China, having more investment and more activity in Central Asia, all things being equal, should be a positive thing. And the last thing I'll say is, when I was in the government, our policy towards Central Asia was to encourage as many pipelines and railroads and roads in all directions as we could possibly get, the concern being that it was totally dominated by Russia in a way that was unhealthy for the stability of those countries. And China was part of the solution to that. And it's a unique part of American diplomacy that one day's solution becomes tomorrow's problem, right? But I'm just not that worried about China's increased influence in Tajikistan. It's just not this. I'll be kept up at night for other reasons. It's not that I'm going to sleep well, but you know that's not going to be one of the reasons. Anyway,
Thank you.
Adir?
Professor Christensen, thanks for your talk. My name's Adir. I'm a sophomore in Rojolton School. And I was wondering, so we often talk
He was a research assistant for my book, just to say. First one listed.
And so I know you often talk about this idea of like, okay, during the Cold War, you had this dichotomy, two powers, US, USSR. Then for a little while, you had just the US. And now you have pretty much US and China, though certainly not in as much of an adversarial role as US and Soviet Union. How much do you think the balance of power will change when you have the BRIC countries, especially India, who's becoming a lot more influential, like more developed, soon more populous than China? Do you think that will change things a lot with like the border dispute between India and China?
No, I don't. I don't think India is likely to close the power gap with China extremely quickly. Mm-hmm. And even if it does, the border dispute between China and India, you know, this is a flat map, right? This is a flat map. There's no topography. Really hard to be too aggressive for too long in that region, right? Those are high mountains. In fact, I think they're the highest. So it's a tough deal to really assert military superiority there. There is also, they're both nuclear states now, and that's a problem. And then I guess in general, people talk about balance of power in this kind of realpolitik, 19th century Europe, early 20th century Europe. So in that sense, the US is doing just fine. I try to outline that in the book. In terms of just raw military power, we've got it all over China. Economic power, we have it all over China. Diplomatic power is incomparably over China. Again, 60 alliances and security partners. China has North Korea. And then it has friends like Zimbabwe, Sudan, Pakistan. Well, good luck with that, right? So the US has a power, that doesn't, then I still don't sleep at night. Why? Because you don't have to be a peer competitor to be a challenge. And I do see China as a challenge, and I take China's military modernization extremely seriously, precisely because I don't think China has to catch up. People talk about the Chinese carrier. It has an aircraft carrier. Ooh, it has an aircraft carrier, right? Where did it get it? Ukraine, that great military power, Ukraine, it purchased an aircraft carrier, right? Now, this is a big concern to Vietnam. It's a big concern to Philippines. It's not a big concern to the U.S. And I know someone who I will not name, who is a very esteemed U.S. national security analyst who spends a lot of time worrying about the Chinese military modernization. And he said something to me. He said, when I dream happy dreams, I dream of new carriers. And then he paused. Chinese carriers. Why? Because Chinese carriers in the 21st century are big honking targets in great power conflict, right? So they have one. We've got 11 nuclear-powered ones going all around the world on a regular basis. We know how to protect them. Stealth fighter. China did a test while Secretary Gates was there. We've had stealth fighters integrated with our military since the 80s, according to public reports. We've got them flying all around the world. They had one that did a test flight. That's not close to us. But do they have to be close to us to pose a challenge? No. So I worry for other reasons, despite that realpolitik balance. And I don't see India, Brazil, the BRICS, South Africa, closing the gap with the United States or its alliance structure anytime soon in that realpolitik sense. So that's not what worries me. Other stuff worries me. So I don't know how optimistic I am. I like it when people say I'm optimistic compared to some others, because some of the others, I think, are a little bit paranoid. But I worry. I worry plenty.
All right. So if you...
Okay, no, you gotta let someone else go, dear.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Hello, my name's Eric. I'm a sophomore in the Woodrow Wilson School. I had a question about China's democratization. Mm-hmm. So I know we hear a lot of news reports that condemn China for not having free, fair, independent elections, for not having enough political freedoms. But I think for some of the problems that you mentioned, environmental problems or disputes over islands, even if China were democratic, those problems still might exist or be even worse. For example, with the environment, China might, even with elected leaders, still find it rational to be a free rider on climate change.
That couldn't happen. Oh, okay. An elected leadership would do nothing about climate change? Bob, does that ever happen in democracies?
Or, I don't know, political might make it even more difficult to pass legislation on the environment with island disputes. Since China has very nationalistic population, they could still...
Okay, no, I get your question. So would democracy solve all of China's problems or all of China's neighbors' problems with China? No. I do think that a liberal democratic, a mature liberal democratic China would deal with its sovereignty disputes in a much more pacific and accommodating way with its democratic neighbors than the current regime does. And here's an example. South Korea and Japan have a dispute over Dokdo, Takashima in Japanese, right? And it's just the same as the Senkaku Diaoyu dispute in intensity. People on both sides really believe the thing's theirs. Does anybody imagine that South Korea and Japan, despite all that historical problems, are going to actually fight over Dokdo? So I do think that there's something to this liberal democratic peace stuff. Right? It doesn't necessarily guarantee the peace, but it makes it much more likely. Now, the problem that I see on that score is how does China get from where it is now to that place, to the mature liberal democracy? You know, you guys are too young to remember I Dream of Genie, so this, you know, you can't just... liberal democratic China, right? You have to, there's a process of getting, and the process of democratization could be full of jingoism and full of real problems. I still think it's a noble goal, and at the end of the day, China is one-fifth of the world's population. So there's a moral imperative that one-fifth of the world's population ought to have a direct voice in its government. Right? Just think about that. One-fifth of the world's population, you're gonna condemn them forever to authoritarianism because there are environmental issues or some other issue? I would say no, right? And the other thing I would say is that when American diplomats push for liberalization of the Chinese political system, whether it be institutional, like independent courts outside of the party, or the allowing lawyers and media people to operate, they're trying to create a more stable China in that process. The accusation in China is that they're rolling this giant Trojan horse in that will cause instability in China, which will make China as a nation weaker. That's not how Americans think about those institutions. We take great pride in those institutions at home as sources of American power. So if we're wishing a country to become more liberal and democratic, we're actually wishing that country well. So this is just a conspiracy theory. And it shows the real gap between what the United States is trying to do. Sometimes we might do it in an arrogant and ill-informed fashion, right? Believe me, there's plenty of that in this country, right? But the impetus, the motivation is a positive one, not just for us, but for them. And it should be pitched that way. And one of the problems with our human rights discussions and our democracy discussions is when Americans say, we need to export American values or Western values. This is nonsense. These are universal values. And America has violated them plenty. Right? So when we did the human rights dialogue in 2008, my superior, my assistant secretary for democracy, rights, and labor, opened the discussion with the Chinese in Beijing with a 20-minute expose on American human rights violations, from slavery to Abu Ghraib. They were stunned. And what was his punchline at the end? We violate them. We have violated them. We didn't treat the Native Americans very well. We haven't treated African Americans very well. Women couldn't vote until the 1920s. More than half the adult population. So we're not perfect, but these are universal values that we're trying to meet, and you should too. Now let's talk about some of your problems. And I think that's the way to approach these things. Like, who gives us intellectual property over righteousness? It's stupid. Anyway, yeah.
Thank you. Hi, Professor. Brendan Cooley, I'm a first-year PhD student in politics. You mentioned that Chinese decision makers actually believe that islands in the East China Sea and South China Sea belong to China.
Yeah, I do believe that. I've been convinced over time that they actually believe, and it worries me.
So I'm wondering where these ideas come from, and if it's just nationalism in its purest form, then what explains variation in how they've pursued these territorial
claims? Okay, so the story is, here's the Chinese story. This nine-dash line here was drawn officially in the 1930s, it was worked into the 1947 Constitution, not of the People's Republic of China, but of the Republic of China, a U.S. ally in World War II. And the argument is that Chiang Kai-shek's government, the Republic of China, had drawn this map, and the other great powers had agreed to it. France, Britain, who were imperial powers in Asia at the time. And if you look at the maps in Taiwan, they're the same. And the president of Taiwan, Ma Ying-jeou, when you get to the East China Sea, he wrote his thesis at Harvard on why the Diaoyu Islands, what the Japanese call Senkaku, are Chinese under the Republic of China, not under the People's Republic of China. Right? So he believes that too. So they go back in history and they say that. And then you go to the Vietnamese and they say, there's one small problem. What were we in the 1930s? A French colony. We didn't have any say. Who cares what the Chinese and the imperial powers of Europe agreed upon while we were a colony? We're no longer a colony, and no, China doesn't get our whole coast, right? So that's also a convincing argument, and this is what worries me, is everybody says this with great passion, I believe with great sincerity, and I've always been looking for that little weakness in the argument that suggested they don't really mean it, and then maybe you can get a diplomatic lever in there, but everyone seems to mean it, and it's dangerous. And you know, the Vietnamese do have a history of standing up to stronger powers.
Hi, Professor. My name is Hannah Kim. I'm now a first-year master's student at the Woodrow Wilson School. You mentioned about how we can use domestic reasons to encourage China to take the right action. And I'm thinking about cases where CCP perceives domestic interests to be in contrast with international interests, such as the island dispute. They think using the island dispute to increase nationalism strengthens the party legitimacy, at least temporarily, oftentimes, I feel. And how do we deal with these situations where CCP perceives domestic interests to be in contrast?
Well, they have various interests, right? They have interests in pursuing and portraying themselves as defenders of the national interest on sovereignty. They have interests in preserving good economic relations with this provider of parts for this transnational production chain. They have interests in not getting in a squabble with a giant superpower, the United States, which is using its military increasingly as a diplomatic tool, both in the East China Sea and the South China Sea, that, in my opinion, appropriately, using the military as a diplomatic tool in those places. But there are other costs that they can pay. So one of the things you can do is just hold them up to their own mantra. They say they want to peacefully resolve the issues. Well, what does that mean? I've never seen any indication that peacefully resolving the disputes with its neighbors imply that China will compromise in any possible way on any of the disputes. So that's not really resolving disputes in a sincere fashion. The only way that stuff is really going to end peacefully for everybody is if everybody gives something up. And there's something that hasn't gotten enough attention in the international hubbub about this, and that is the Philippines has redrawn its map, its traditional map, in a way that's consistent with the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea from the 1970s. If other actors did that, there'd be much more room to actually negotiate a settlement, right? So that should be a model. That doesn't come out very much, that they actually, it's not impossible for a post-colonial nationalist regime to redraw a map, and the Philippines is certainly a post-colonial nationalist regime. I said China has post-colonial nationalism in spades, and it does. The problem is China was never a colony. My colleague at Lucian Pai at MIT used to call China sore winners, because they have the same narrative of post-colonial nationalism, but they actually won against Japan. They won the war, right? And the Europeans never really fully colonized. Even Mao called it a semi-colony. So anyway, so they have the same kind of narrative, but they did redraw the map, so it is possible. And they're a democracy. Who asked a democracy question? They're a democracy, and they did it, right? And it didn't cause massive instability. Richard, thank you for your question.
Hi, Professor Christensen. My name is Richard. I'm a junior in the Woodrow Wilson School. I wanted to ask you about recent events in China's domestic situation, specifically the passing of the new foreign NGO law, the national security law, and the anti-terrorism law. It seems that this summer has been a real tightening of China's, with the 300 lawyer crackdown. And I was wondering what kind of, like, President Xi Jinping seems to have been consolidating power at a much more rapid pace than any of his predecessors. I was wondering if this has any implications for U.S.-China relations, and what the proper response, what is the proper U.S. response for the alarming just violations of human rights and the political tightening of China's environment?
I'm alarmed. I didn't have great hopes that a transition would lead to massive changes and all these other things, but things are getting worse in China on academic freedoms, on media freedoms, on legal freedoms, on NGOs in the last few years. They were getting worse in the last years of Hu Jintao, and they're getting worse under the current leadership. And I'm concerned about it. What can you do about it? Again, it's not like the U.S. can dictate to China to change its internal policies. You can criticize it. Now, some people would say you have to sanction China. You should cut off economically. I don't think that's an effective tool. So I think you have to have discussions with China. You have to hold China's reputation to task all the time, because the reputation of China does matter to Chinese elites and to the Chinese public. But I don't think you can, at the end of the day, simply by coercion, whether it be economic coercion or military coercion, solve that problem. I think it's just pathetically sad. I think Chinese citizens should be really sad about it. Why is this country that says it's now a great power and has this, you know, ridiculously militaristic 70th anniversary parade for the victory over Japan, says, well, we're so confident, we're so strong, why are they so afraid of a few NGOs? Isn't that embarrassing? If I were a Chinese citizen, I would be embarrassed. Why are you so afraid of a couple of school teachers who want to organize around some theme in some village to make a better life for people? Why is that so scary? Why are you such control freaks? And I think at the end of the day, it's because they're scared. They're trained to be scared because they're Leninists. Like, they're born to be scared, right? And now they're particularly scared since the financial crisis, because the financial crisis made China seem stronger on the international stage, but it called into question the ability to keep this economic growth model going. And that's a major source of legitimacy long into the future. So now they're really worried about domestic legitimacy. And that was true under Hu Jintao, too. Things were not good in 2010, 2011, when I was over there. And they're not good now for academics. It's sad. I have lots of friends who are academics. It's sad. You know, to have to clear with the party chief every talk that's given. It's pathetic. Some professor, and then they ban people from going. You know, we have colleagues here who can't go to China, right? It's probably my wife's greatest desire for me to be deported. She's in the audience. But they can't go to China. It's pathetic. Like, I had a colleague at MIT, Peter Perdue, a historian. He wrote about Xinjiang. That was his big problem. He wrote a book that covered the history of Xinjiang. He can't go to China because he's a threat to national security. Really, Peter Perdue? I've known him a while. He's not a bomb thrower. Really? So what are you so afraid of if you're such a great power? So you're not going to get national. That's the approach. I don't know a better approach. I don't think economic sanctions work for this purpose. They've been tried. They're usually counterproductive. And then you have these dialogues, and you try to get people out when you can. But you know, it's good. I believe in individual rights. So you get an individual out. That's great. Great for that individual, great for that individual's family. That's a whole universe. You know, I was raised Catholic. That's a whole universe. Right? So that's a great thing you've done. But then they leave China. And it's sad. Because these are forces for good, and now they're out of the country. They're much less powerful. So it's tough. There's no easy answers. That's the kind of stuff that kept me up at night. That, North Korean refugees. Talk about a sad state of affairs. Being a North Korean refugee on the run, that's rough. You know, you do what you can.
Yeah, thank you.
I wish I had a better answer. Choked up now. Ma'am.
Hi, I'm Zoe. I'm a senior in the East Asian Studies department. I actually asked for a Peter Padu book at a Chinese library. It didn't go over well.
Oh, in the mainland?
Yeah, I was in Tsinghua over the summer. I'm sorry, it's spring.
But his books, you know, his books are not like particularly aggressive in any way. He just kind of says this was an imperial struggle between Russia and China and Xinjiang, which is all true.
Yeah, it didn't go well at the library. I haven't been back. But I have a question pertaining to Xi Jinping's current administration and its relationship with the military. He had this huge military parade, and he announced he's cutting the ranks. Has that relationship changed very much between Xi Jinping's administration and Hu Jintao's?
The difference between Xi Jinping's administration and Hu Jintao's administration, it seems to me, is not so much civil military affairs writ large. It's Xi Jinping's willingness to go after very powerful people in an aggressive way at home. That's really the marked difference. And that includes the military. He went after a very, very high-ranking general in Xu Saiho, right? Guo Boshong. These are really high-level people, much higher level than a lot of other people that get mentioned in these discussions. So if you're a high-level military officer, you better not ignore what Xi Jinping has to say. I don't buy the argument that the military is a rogue element. It's a party army, it's a structured system, and the head of the Central Military Commission, which is President Xi Jinping, controls the military. I think they do things that he might not like and know about, but I don't think that they are a rogue army that's going to declare war on the neighbors without his knowledge or refuse to fight if he orders them to fight. I don't think it's like that at all. And I don't think that was true under Hu Jintao either. But he has gone after the military. And he seems dedicated to creating a real fighting military. One of the many ways that the United States military is superior to the Chinese military is there's nobody in the Chinese military with any real fighting experience. Right? So the only war that any of them even remember is the 1979 ground invasion of Vietnam, which went very poorly for China. They have no experience, sustained experience at projecting maritime power or air power offshore. And the U.S. military, for better or worse, a lot of people would say worse, has tremendous experience fighting all over the world all the time. We've been at war somewhere pretty much consistently since the Cold War ended. So our military knows how to do the logistics and all the other stuff and to actually fight. So that's a problem. And I think Xi Jinping is trying to get the military in China to actually learn how to fight. And that means they can't be corrupt. They have to train. So I remember when the Chinese military was in business, they used to own hotels and brothels and all sorts of stuff like that. And I remember I talked to an attaché from a country other than China, I won't say which country, who said, I study the Chinese military because the Chinese military could be a lot stronger than it is. And you know what? I love professional Chinese soldiers when soldiering is not their profession. I love it when they run hotels. I love it when they run brothels because they're not training to fight me. But Xi Jinping wants these people to be a real military, not a corrupt organization that to become a general, you have to give a giant bribe regardless of your quality. Right? I think he's dedicated to that. And I think that's popular in the public. I think the problem with the anti-corruption drive is systemically it can't succeed over time without structural change in China. You can't have a truly successful, persistent anti-corruption drive when the courts are controlled by the same party that's being prosecuted and where the defendants often outrank the judges. And you can't have a truly effective, persistent anti-corruption drive when you don't have a free media, and you can't have a truly successful, persistent anti-corruption drive if you don't have lawyers who are able to defend journalists who do exposés without themselves going to jail. So it's not going to work, it seems to me, but it is popular. Is it better than the alternative? Maybe. But it's going to probably produce a stronger Chinese military, not a weaker one. So I don't like that part. You know, I don't think China's going to take over the world or anything, but, you know, all things being equal, the one part of China's growth and power that I would like to see slow down a bit is the military piece. China's economy slows down, it's bad for us. China's diplomacy grows through constructive behavior, that's good for us. China's military grows, I'm not so convinced that's in our interest.
Thank you so much for coming today. My name's Nicholas Wu, and I'm a sophomore, potentially going to be in the Woodrow Wilson School. So I think there's one continent that's been absent in the talk today, and that's been Africa.
Africa, okay,
so
thank you for raising it.
I feel like every now and then there's a news story that rolls around that talks about Chinese investment in Africa and bemoans the lack of American investment there. So with regard to American policy towards that, do you think that should be a major concern?
We have a lot more investment in Africa than China does. Investment, right? Which is fine, we're a bigger economy in terms of investment capital. China's catching up, right? But China has more trade than the United States with Africa, and that's a new thing. That's a relatively new phenomenon. Until about 2008, 2009, the United States had more trade with Africa than China. China has surpassed the United States, and then people got really worried about it. Here's the problem. Why did that happen? One of the major reasons that happened was fracking. We were getting resources from Africa, and we suddenly could get them more cheaply at home. Right? Another reason is that China's more dependent on import of resources, especially energy resources, than before. Now, I recall in American domestic politics, I have an economist here on my right, so I recognize her, so she can correct me if I'm wrong. I remember, you know, these discussions on both sides of the aisle that when America gets energy independence, we'll have security. Well, this is stupid. It's economically stupid, and it's strategically stupid, right? So the United States burns a lot of energy. That raises the world price by a certain amount when we do that. We can get the energy from home, or we can get the energy from abroad. We have a strong market, lots and lots of producers. No one has monopoly production. It doesn't matter whether we import it or we buy it from home, except that when you buy it from home, you get the people who produce it here get richer. So people say we'll have security if we have energy independence. That's wrong, because the people in the Middle East who have the energy, who are selling it at windfall profits to other people besides the United States, will still be a concern of ours, because they're going to be able to use those windfall profits for purposes we might not like. Right? Is this correct? Correct me when I'm wrong. She's a real economist. Right? I have a doctorate in philosophy. So. So we're still going to be concerned about this area, so we can't get lazy about it. But nobody in the United States says we would be stronger if we bought more energy from the Middle East. Nobody in that debate says, if only we bought more energy from Qatar or from Saudi Arabia, we would be stronger. That would be crazy, right? That would be almost as crazy as the initial statement that energy independence is going to give us security. But when China buys more energy from Africa, they have hearings on Capitol Hill. Why is China having our diplomatic lunch by buying more stuff from Africa than we are? Well, that's because China's more dependent on energy imports than before. If that makes them secure, why don't energy imports make us more secure? Well, because in politics, a lot of things aren't logical. Right? And we're going to have a speaker here. I can do an advertiser. Deborah Brodigam's going to come here. There was one of the myths about China is that China's buying up Africa for farm purposes, and she's going to try to put an end to that myth. I can't let you ask another question. I see you gearing up, but I can't let you ask another one. Thank you for your question. Yeah.
Hi, my name is David Logan. I'm a first-year MPA student in the Wilson School. Mm-hmm. I want to go back to the beginning of your talk, because I'm very interested in the security component of the relationship. And you talked about some of these new military capabilities, like the diesel submarines.
They're not that new, but they're getting better.
Right. So I guess my question, when I talk to Chinese nationals who do research on security issues, many of them will counter the idea that they have this so-called anti-access area denial strategy.
Yeah, they don't.
And earlier this year, there was, I guess that was what I was going at.
That's
article.
An American invention, but go ahead. Yeah.
Well, my question was, one, do you think it exists? And two, no. Do you think that it matters?
It would matter if China could deny us access to the Western Pacific. It would matter greatly. But they can't, and they know they can't. So I don't think their strategy is to deny the US access to the Western Pacific. Their strategy is, if you want to use your presence in the Western Pacific for purposes that we don't like, we're going to make it costly for you to be there, which is different than anti-access. Anti-access is a brute force concept. You can't get your submarines in. You can't get your boats in. You can't get your planes in, because we'll stop them in piece by piece by piece. They will not get there. I don't think China has that pretense or that capability. That is a Pentagon expression. I've never seen the equivalent in Chinese writings, including, again, in writings that are secret in the Chinese system that are available in libraries, nothing that I got from my government work. Right? You don't see anti-access area. What you see is counter-intervention. What is that? Again, raising the cost of intervening forces on issues that China believes it cares more about than the superior power. The Assassin's Mace is the same idea. And they called, I watched the parade. I was in China for the parade. They had the DF-21, right? Which is the version of the DF-21 missile can hit a moving ship at sea. That's the anti-ship ballistic missile. And they described it on the central CCTV as the Assassin's Mace, right? We can use weapons that leverage our geographic position and the reliance of superior powers on certain systems to raise those costs to a very high level, right? Does that mean they're going to dominate the world with a DF-21 D missile? No. Does it mean that the U.S. Navy has to take that extremely seriously? Absolutely. And they do. We took it seriously when it was under development. We take it seriously now. And they do use the term assassins. Shasho Jin, they say that. So, yeah, so we invent all sorts of concepts for them. And what happens sometimes is we'll invent a concept in the Pentagon. They'll write a report on it. Some Chinese security analyst at the Academy of Military Sciences will translate it into Chinese and then write about it. And then an American intelligence officer will find the Chinese article, translate it back into English, and say, see? I've actually seen this happen. You can't make this stuff up. This is real government work.
Hi, my name is Tim. I'm hoping to be a student next year in the PhD program, but we'll see. My question is, if you look at a lot of the statements from the CCP, the diplomatic statements, they're not always the most diplomatic. They're often highly acerbic, perhaps somewhat indignant. Yeah. Not all, but some.
Yeah, a lot especially, of them. Yeah, it's kind of sad.
Do you think that's ultimately counterproductive? I think sometimes it makes China look perhaps even weaker than it really is.
Oh, yeah, yeah. China shoots itself in the foot over and over again all the time. And sometimes it's because of bad diplomacy, because the diplomats don't know how to handle a situation. I think in a lot of cases, it's because the diplomats don't have the decision-making authority to say what they really think, and they're just following through with they're parroting the orders that they receive. I've been in lots of meetings where I had tremendous respect for the person across the table from me, and I felt like what was being read to me was a hostage note. You know? I've been instructed to tell you that you must not do this because it is a violation of the spirit of cooperation and it is an insult to the 1.3 billion Chinese people whose feelings are hurt. I'm like, really? Have you done a poll? You know? But you know, they have to do this stuff, and it's sometimes it's sad because the diplomatic corps in China is actually increasingly sophisticated, increasingly professional, but they're under very strict political constraints. And there is this message that we're a victim, 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 and if you forgot, we're a victim.
Thank you. My name is Young Kim. I'm from Consulate General's Office of New York, South Korea.
Oh, not welcome, North Korea. Sir. Welcome, sir.
Actually, thank
our
you.
Allies.
For, oh, yeah, our allies. Thank you for sharing your insight, and thank you for reminding me my bad memories in Beijing in 2010. Actually, I was there to persuade China.
My condolences, yeah.
To persuade China, criticize North Korea publicly, but actually, you know, it was mission impossible, and we failed.
Yeah.
And my question is about the role of South Korea. Actually, sometimes the United States urges South Korea to have some kind of good relationship with China and make China move in the right direction regarding North Korea issues. And but sometimes, you know, U.S. criticize some complaints about South Korea's tilting too much to China.
Yeah.
That's kind of complicated. Yeah. But yeah, so what do you think the proper role or proper attitude of South Korean government in between United States and China?
Okay, that's a very complicated question to end on. And it provides me the opportunity to say that everything I say in response to your question is my own personal opinion and does not represent the views of the U.S. government. And that applies to everything else I said before because I still consult for the U.S. government and, you know, I'm not supposed to represent the U.S. government. Even, you know, my wife says, you know, no, that's not a problem. No one thinks your views represent anyone else's views. So, so I think South, you know, my general view of South Korea is a miracle. South Korea is a great ally. South Korea is a vibrant democracy. South Korea is a country that has recently become a developed country and is much as a great bridge for the United States on many of the problems I talked about. When I was in the government, I used to play this up all the time. South Korea is the government that we should be coordinating most closely with on global warming. Because we're asking developing countries to make sacrifices, and South Korea remembers being a developing country, because it's relatively recent. So South Korea can play all sorts of constructive roles. And my sense is, sir, that the differences between the United States and South Korea on issues related to China and North Korea are really differences in strategy and tactics. That sometimes the South Koreans think the United States is too soft on something, and sometimes we think the South Koreans are too soft on something. Sometimes we think the South Koreans are too hard on something, and sometimes they think the United States is too hard on something. And in general, does the United States want South Korea to have good relations with China? Yes. The answer is yes. That's a very simple answer. Does that mean that the context can't be such that the United States might not think this is the best moment to have a big hug of Beijing? That this might not be the best moment, yeah, that also happens, right? So, I mean, we're good allies, proven allies, right? I miss government work when I say stuff like that. But welcome, sir. Thank you. Welcome to Princeton, and thanks for your service. So.